So when approaching the issue of anxiety, first off, it's important to recognize that everything within the context of Buddhism is related to the quest for enlightenment. It's related to our endeavor to attain awakening. So then it's recognizing that any manifestation of greed, hatred, or delusion is an indication that we're not yet awakened. And the root cause of that manifesting defilement needs to be addressed. It needs to be taken care of. It needs to be eliminated. So what is anxiety? Anxiety at its heart is a manifestation of aversion and delusion. It's a manifestation of, first off, a misunderstanding of our situation, combined with an attitude of rejecting or dislike or trying to avoid or eliminate some aspect of our experience. Either a dislike of something that's presently happening or a fear of something that might happen. Fear of a possible future, aversion to a possible future, dislike of a possible future. So when dealing with aversion, it's then first important to recognize that that state of aversion is an unwholesome mind state. The state of fear is an unwholesome mind state. The state of anxiety is an unwholesome mind state. And this might not sound like the most pleasant way of starting things. It's like, oh, well, I'm experiencing this terrible experience of anxiety. Why are you saying it's unwholesome? It's like, well, because it is. It's a manifestation of unwholesome tendencies. It's a manifestation of, fear, aversion, and delusion. So an enlightened being does not experience anxiety because their mind is free of defilements. Therefore, anxiety is a product of defilement. It's something which is really inescapable. One of the titles, one of the epithets or descriptions of enlightened beings is fearless. Enlightened beings are completely free of fear. They're immune to fear. They're beyond fear. Fear has no hold on them. So recognizing, first off, that it's possible to have a mind which is immune to fear, a mind which is immune to anxiety, a mind which is not prone to that, actually any afflictive mind state, but to that afflictive condition in particular. Then we can start to approach our issue of anxiety with some understanding as to why we're coming at it. Because you can go to a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a therapist, and they'll also talk about overcoming anxiety, but they'll be coming at it from a completely different angle. So with Buddhism, we're only really interested in what leads towards awakening. We're not interested in what makes somebody a productive member of society or what makes them a good capitalist or what makes them whatever it is they want to be. That's completely irrelevant. Buddhism is solely concerned with the path to enlightenment. It's not concerned with anything else. So when we talk about dealing with anxiety, it must be taken within that context. So coming then to the issue of anxiety, one thing that I usually emphasize when talking about anxiety is that the first step is recognizing that there are two separate sets of phenomena going on. When we're experiencing anxiety, there's two different things going on. There's a physical experience, and there's a mental experience. So the physical experience of anxiety, this actually is where I recommend it's usually easier to start to get a hold on the situation. Start to deal with the problem in a very direct, immediate way. So one of the major elements of Buddhist practice is mindfulness of the body. In fact, that was the main meditation that I was instructing in earlier. So developing a clear, immediate understanding of our body. Yeah, and not an intellectual understanding, but a direct experience a knowing, a direct knowing of our physical experience moment by moment. And with that direct knowing, also cultivating a sense of equanimity, of a stable, non-reactive awareness of our physical experience. So knowing whatever sensation arises, and knowing whatever sensation ceases, without any disturbance in the mind. So not bothered by any sensation that comes or goes. And that depends upon clear awareness. Without clear awareness of our physical experience, it's very difficult to have any sense of mental stability towards our physical experience. We'll constantly be blindsided by things which seem to just come up out of nowhere and disturb the mind. But actually, it's not that it's coming out of nowhere, it's that we're not paying attention. And it's not that the sensations are disturbing the mind, it's that we are not restraining our mind. It's that we are engaging in habits of reactivity, habits of volatile engagement with whatever is appearing in the body, whatever sensations are appearing in the body. So starting by cultivating mindfulness in the body, coupled with equanimity, with a stable, unagitated, undisturbed awareness of our physical experience. So then with anxiety, paying attention to the physical symptoms. So what changes in the body? How does the bodily experience change when we're experiencing anxiety? So that can vary a little bit from person to person or from experience to experience, but generally speaking, you might notice things like increased heart rate, increased blood pressure, a sense of heat in the body, a sense of tension in the body. You can experience a lot of different particular symptoms. But no matter what sensations are appearing in the body, without going directly into the mental judgment, I am experiencing anxiety, this is uncomfortable, this is unpleasant, I don't want this, I can't stand this, this shouldn't be happening, I don't want this to happen. Without going into any of that mental reactivity, just start by staying with the physical experience. So for example, if your heart is beating quickly, just stay with the feeling of your heart beating quickly. What does it feel like? Actually, it doesn't feel much different from the heart beating slowly. It's just a little bit faster. There's not actually anything wrong there. It's just your heart beating. Your heart's always beating. If your heart's not beating, then there's something seriously wrong. So if your heart's beating quickly, well, that's actually nothing to be disturbed about. It's nothing to be worried about. If you go out jogging, then your heart will start beating very quickly, but that doesn't mean you're having an anxiety attack. It just means your heart is beating quickly. It's a physiological response to activity. It's not something which is inherently a problem. So cultivating that same awareness, if you're experiencing, for example, a fast heart rate, just stay with the experience as just a sensation that's arising and ceasing, not something that's inherently problematic or inherently disturbing. It's just a sensation. So whether it's a sensation of a fast heart rate, or a sensation of muscle tension, or a sensation of high blood pressure, or a sensation of whatever it is, whatever symptoms you normally get with anxiety, well, just recognizing it's just that much. It's just a physical sensation. By itself, it's meaningless. It only has the meaning that we give to it. So just don't give it a meaning. Let it be what it is, which is purely physical data, physical information. That's it. It's not good, it's not bad, it's just physical data. That's it. And staying grounded in the body, staying centered in this clear, stable awareness of the body, also goes a long way towards preventing one from getting caught up in the mental experience of anxiety as well. So actually a very potent way of dealing with anxiety is whenever we notice that kind of repetitive, fearful thinking going on, stop whatever you're doing and focus on your feet. amazing how many problems this solves. And it sounds so like simple, almost like banal, but it works. Just try it and see what happens. Stop and focus on your feet. Just focus on your feet for a few seconds. So I don't actually particularly recommend focusing on your breathing. You can, if you like, but pay close attention to what's happening. Because some people find that when they focus on their breathing, that then they start breathing faster. And because they're breathing faster, then they start to feel anxious. And because they're feeling anxious, they breathe faster. And because they're breathing faster, they get anxious. So focusing on your breathing is not necessarily the best option if you're feeling anxious. Or maybe focusing on the breathing, and it's like, oh no, I'm breathing too fast, I need to breathe slower. And that also can trigger more anxiety in the mind. So sometimes actually getting as far away from your mind, as far away from your breathing as possible. So taking your attention all the way down to your feet is one way of starting to break the cycle that we're caught in. The cycle that we're perpetuating. So, then looking at the mental components of anxiety. So here also we can divide it, broadly speaking, into two major categories. So one is the layer of active thinking. So we might have some active thinking going on related to something that's happened, or something that might happen in the future, or something that we're worried might be going on, or some story that we have about the way things are, or the way things might be. So there's a level of active thinking, of storytelling in the mind. And first off, just recognize that 99% of the stories we tell ourselves are utter BS. It's utter nonsense. But I'll come back to that in a moment. And the other layer is beneath the verbal. So beneath the verbal layer of mind, there's this vast sea of non-verbal mental activity. And this is something which, through meditation practice, we start to become more clearly aware of this vast depth of mental activity. It can actually be a little bit disturbing during a meditation retreat. During a meditation retreat, maybe in the first few periods of meditation, maybe the first couple days even, it feels like, okay, we're slowing down the mind, we're dropping the outer layers of mental activity, the mind is becoming very peaceful and settled, and the body is very peaceful and settled, and we're like, okay, this is good, I'm getting very peaceful. At some point, we start to become aware of just how unsettled, agitated, and unstable the mind is. So what we're starting to recognize is beneath the really obvious storms on the surface of the mind, beneath that, there's all these waves and currents in the mind, which most of the time we're not even aware of. So normally we have this conception that like there's like the mind is this like solid concrete block, and then on the top there's all this like chaotic mental activity, and then if we just clear out the chaos on the top, then the mind will be stable. That's not even remotely close to the truth, I'm sorry to tell you. So there is that layer of chaos on the surface, but beneath that there's another layer of chaos, and beneath that there's another layer of chaos. And beneath that, there's another layer of chaos. Until finally, actually, way down at the bottom somewhere, there actually is stability. But just so you know, you're not going to get there anytime soon. It is there. But it takes quite a bit of time and practice to get to the point of the mind being actually stable. And actually, getting past the verbal layer of mind is way towards the beginning. There's a lot of work to be done after that. So stabilizing the non-verbal layers of mind is much more challenging and involved process than dealing with the verbal layer of mind. So coming back to the issue of anxiety, fearful thinking, fearful repetitive mental activity, there's the activity on the verbal layer of mind, Which is where we spend most of our ordinary waking life, by the way. Unless you're a very skilled practitioner who does a lot of meditation on a day-to-day basis, who's developed a deep familiarity and control of your own mind. So setting aside that case, which is not most people, the majority of the time we're dwelling in this outermost chaotic level of verbal thinking. Very rarely do we go beneath that, except again during meditation, and particularly during meditation retreats. So here, when dealing with anxiety, what we're particularly looking for is the story. In order to start to break through this. So looking for the story, what are we telling ourselves? What story have we built up in the mind? What is it that we're afraid of? What is it that we're worried about? What is it that we're anxious about? And then we have a couple of options. One option is to just crush that out of the mind by forcefully focusing the mind on something else. So it's a very direct way. So like during the meditation, I was recommending if there's a lot of mental distraction, then repeating the word focus, 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 focus. So that's an example of a way of just pushing everything else out of the mind. Just devoting all of your verbal thinking activity to a single activity, which has nothing to do with everything else that we normally do with our mind. So this is just a way of replacing self-destructive mental activity with neutral mental activity, which is a tremendous improvement, it has to be said. So that's one way of dealing with it, is through replacement. Another thing is to replace it with something wholesome. So for example, during loving-kindness meditation. So you might start actively using any of the hundreds of different ways of doing loving-kindness meditation. One of the simple ones is just to wish, may everyone be happy, may everyone be happy, may everyone be happy. And engaging in that activity of bringing up this wholesome, pure-hearted, genuine wish for all beings to be happy. Well, as you focus your mind on that activity, then the mind just won't be engaging in any other activity. So that anxious, repetitive thinking will start to dissipate because we're not feeding it, we're not engaging in it anymore. We're engaging in a completely different mental activity, the activity of generating loving kindness, of generating this bright, wholesome, loving mind. It just pushes out all of that anxious, fearful thinking. So these are some ways that we can engage with it. And actually focusing on your body is another way of dealing with it, because as long as our attention is completely focused just on feeling our body, then we don't have any bandwidth in our mind to engage in any kind of fearful thinking. There's just not space there. Because if you put 100% of your mind on feeling your feet, then you have 0% left for anxious thinking. This is pretty basic math. I'm actually not very good at math. I can only do really simple things like this. There's 100% and 0%. So that's what we're aiming at. That actually used to be good at math, but I've lost it. 15 years as a monk, not using any math. It's all gone. So like, I used to know a bunch of like calculus and all that stuff, and it's just gone. It's hopeless. It's hard for me even to do multiplication these days. But that's what calculators are for. Totally different subject. So. Actually, that's another thing. If you're in school and you're anxious and worried about how you're possibly going to learn and remember all this stuff, just keep in mind that 99% of it you will never use for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so coming back to the subject of anxiety. So that's one approach to this anxious, fearful thinking, is you just put the mind on something else, either something neutral or something wholesome. And if you focus entirely on that, then the anxious thinking will disappear, just because we're not doing it anymore. It will fade away from the mind. Generally, quite quickly. If you actually focus wholeheartedly on the object, it will disappear immediately. If we're focusing less than 100%, then it will take a bit of time for the anxious thinking to dissipate. Another way of working through it is to look at the story and start to recognize how incredibly absurd the story is. So exactly how to do this varies dramatically because it depends upon the exact nature of your particular anxiety story. Depends on what exactly it is you're fearful about or worried about. So there's a number of ways of dealing with this. One is to look, what is the attachment that's involved here? What is it that I'm attached to? And recognize that whatever you're attached to is already impermanent, unstable, ephemeral, insubstantial, not really existing in the first place. So attachment to whatever it is completely absurd. You're attaching to a phantom. You're attaching to a mirage. So you're attaching to a daydream. So it's one thing is just to recognize that wherever there's attachment, it's already absurd. By its definition, it's ridiculous. If it's connected with the belief that something will make us happy, like, oh, well, I'm really worried that I'm not going to get that job because if I get that job, then everything will be okay. Wait a minute, let's look at that story. If I get that job, then everything will be okay. Is that a true statement? Is that a true story? No, of course not. It's ridiculous. Whether you get the job or not, nothing is okay. So just acknowledging that, right? From the start. Because there's a basic problem here, which is that we're not enlightened, which means nothing will ever be okay until we attain enlightenment. So, did I just make things worse? Okay. This actually is how I deal with my issues, by the way. So it works for me. I hope it works for somebody else as well. Yeah, so if it's related to, or if it's like, well, I really want to get with that person who I have a crush on. If I do, then that would just be so wonderful. Or I really want to get into that party, which should be magnificent. Or I really want to do this, or I really want to do that. Or I really want to achieve this or attain that. Or, well, whatever it is, recognizing that the thing that you're craving, the thing that you're seeking, is incapable of making you happy. It's just another temporary, unsatisfying thing, like everything else. So whether we get it or not, doesn't make the slightest bit of difference. Our happiness is a decision that we make. Our contentment is a decision that we make. Our satisfaction is a decision that we make. So rather than get so wrapped up in whether or not we get something that we want, why don't we just focus on letting go of the wanting? Wouldn't that be so much simpler? So we don't actually need to be worried about whether or not we're going to get what we want. We should be far more worried about the fact that we're wrapped up in wanting. We should be far more worried about all of the attachment that we're fueling in our mind. Or if it's fear, actually another great one on attachment, but it's worry about not getting something pleasant. There's a really great sutta on this from the Anamataga Samyutta. So the Anamataga Samyutta is one of my favorite parts of the Pali Canon. But I say that about so many parts of the Pali Canon that it's almost a meaningless statement. But the Anamataga Samyutta is the chapter on, Bhikkhu Bodhi translates it, without discoverable beginning. So it's a series of suttas which starts with the Buddha saying, samsara has no discoverable beginning. Samsara is the cycle of delusional existence, which all of us are caught in, by the way. Unless it's just me and the rest of you are Buddhas, but I don't think that's the case. It could be my own delusion of seeing all of you as unenlightened beings. I don't think so. Anybody here think they're a Buddha? No? Okay, this might still be my delusion, but we'll go with it. So, the Anamataka Samyutta. Samsara is without discoverable beginning, the Buddha says. And in one of these suttas, he says, whenever you see somebody experiencing something pleasant, you can reflect. At some point in this long course of life after life after life, I have had exactly the same pleasant experience. So why would you want it again? You already had it. And it didn't make you happy last time. It didn't solve your problems last time. You still kept spinning around in the cycle of pain and torment. So what's the point? Whatever it is you think you want, whatever it is you think will make you happy, you already had it and it didn't solve a single thing. So what's the point in seeking it again? And so what's the point in being bothered about not getting it? What's the point in being bothered about the possibility that you might not get something that won't make you happy anyway? Do you start to see how we can break down our story? Break down our story into individual components of delusion. This is why, from the beginning, I said that one of the main components of anxiety is delusion. It's built upon a misunderstanding of our experience, a misunderstanding of the nature of experience. So as we start to more closely examine the story, then we realize that the story is built up out of two components, defilements and delusions. So as we piece that apart, we can start to drop it piece by piece. Or maybe it's a different form. Maybe it's anxiety or worry or fear connected with the possibility that something unpleasant might happen, something painful or disturbing might happen. Well, again, let's look at that scenario. First off, acknowledging that just as you've had every pleasant experience at some point or another, you've also had every unpleasant experience at one point. So whatever it is you're worried about happening, whatever terrible thing you're worried might happen, it's already happened, and somehow you came out okay. There might have been some misery and torment along the way, but that's samsara. There's always misery and torment along the way. It kind of goes with the package. So acknowledging that whatever you're afraid of happening, it's already happened. And you turned out all right after all. So if this does happen, it's not going to be the end of the world. I mean, it might be, but we've been through the end of the world countless times. So it's really not the end of the world if it actually is the end of the world. It's not a problem if it's the end of the world. It's not a problem if something awful happens. As long as we face it with poise, dignity, mindfulness, equanimity, wisdom, gentleness, then there's not a problem. No matter what terrible thing happens, as long as we face it with a completely wholesome, pure mind, it isn't a problem. So then the immediate situation of being worried or anxious or fearful of something unpleasant potentially happening in the future, well, that's just unnecessarily creating something unpleasant in the present. Namely, the experience of anxiety. So it's also a very important thing to recognize, if it isn't completely clear by now, just that anxiety is entirely self-generated. Nobody else can make you anxious. Nothing in the outside world can make you anxious. Only you can. We each have the power to determine the state of our own mind. So for experiencing anxiety, it's because we're making some pretty foolish choices with our mind, to be completely blunt about it. So it's recognizing that we don't need to create more misery and torment for ourselves. We're already quite skilled at doing that. So it's time to start developing the skill of not doing that, of not tormenting ourselves, of not unnecessarily making ourselves suffer, and it's never necessary to make ourselves suffer. And also coming again to the future. Again, we actually have no idea what's going to happen in the future. So having any kind of fear or worry about the future is, again, it's based on daydreams. It's based on fantasies, illusions, imaginings in the mind. Now, we really do not have any clue what's going to happen, even 5 minutes from now, let alone 5 years from now. What we do know is that if we face any situation with a calm, stable, wholesome mind, We also know that if we face any situation with an unstable, unwholesome mind, then it will not be okay. In fact, it will be a flaming disaster. This we also know. So then, once again, our priority should be cultivating a stable, wholesome mind. So worrying about what might happen or what might not happen is completely irrelevant and useless to this basic principle of cultivating the stability, the equanimity, to face every possible situation with clarity and dignity. And this is something then which naturally happens as we cultivate our practice. And again, practice is not just meditation, it's the whole Noble Eightfold Path. As we cultivate our practice, we start to develop the confidence that we can face any situation with dignity. So it starts with small things. Like you feel a little bit of pain during meditation and you sit still for a few seconds longer than usual. Might not seem like a big deal at the time, but actually that's laying the foundation stones for facing absolutely any situation, no matter how horrific. Facing any situation with a stable, non-reactive mind. Or when your coworker says something rude and you just let it slip off your back rather than issuing a witty rebuttal. Again, it seems like a small, simple thing, but it's laying the foundation stones for an invincible mind, an unshakable mind, an imperturbable mind, a rock-solid mind. So making that effort, this is another aspect of anxiety. So a long while back, I was there was a certain senior monk who was talking about the same topic. He was talking about anxiety. And somebody asked him about dealing with anxiety. He made a very interesting answer. He said, practice morality. It's like, what? What does that have anything to do with dealing with anxiety? And what he said is, he said, if you are a moral person, if you practice morality and virtue, then anxiety will not arise in the first place. So up till now, I've been talking entirely about triage, emergency room stuff. Like, what do you do when you're already immersed deep in anxiety? But this other monk, he was coming at it from entirely the opposite perspective. He was like, well, how do you prevent it from arising in the first place? He's like, well, there's a very simple answer, morality. Be a completely good person all the time, and then anxiety will not arise in your mind. Now, I actually could go a little bit with that. I would say it's also important to develop samadhi, and it's also important to develop wisdom. But that foundation of morality actually solves about 99% of our ordinary day-to-day problems. Cultivating that mind of genuine kindness and consideration towards every being that we encounter, including ourselves, already starts to eliminate the vast majority of the mind states that form a basis for anxiety. So cultivating that wholesomeness of mind then gives us a natural resistance, a natural immunity to the arising of anxiety in the first place. So coming back though to dealing with the mental components of anxiety. So I spoke a little bit about dealing with the stories. Ajahn Chah spoke about this in a much more direct way, by the way. Ajahn Chah said, no matter what your mind is saying, point your finger at it and say, liar! So that's his approach to dealing with anxiety. That also works. So I'm giving a lot of different methods, so you can try a lot of different things. If that one works for you, bonus points. Whatever works, really. That was another thing Ajahn Chah said, do whatever works. Different people have said that, but I like it best in the context of Buddhist practice. Do whatever works. So again, there's the layer of the story, but beneath that, there's the layer of motion or non-verbal thought patterns, non-verbal movements of mind, where there's not a specific story, there's just this nameless feeling of dread. This is a little bit more challenging. It's not something we're feeling in the body exactly. So mindfulness of the body is not helping here. There's not a story connected with it. So trying to crush out the verbal thinking or analyze and break down the silliness of the story, those aren't going to work here either. What is necessary here then is, first off, to allow yourself to feel it completely, which is a little bit counterintuitive. But the problem here is the function of ignorance. It's the function of delusion. So when we are not willing to face our situation straight up, just as it is, when we're not willing to look our own mind in the eyes, so to speak, then there's very little we can do about it. Again, it's like if you go to the doctor and the doctor's like, so what are your symptoms? And you're like, oh, nothing. Nope, nothing's wrong. Totally fine. Bye. Well, the doctor can't help you, can they? You have to be willing to acknowledge what your symptoms are before the doctor can do anything to help you. So it's the same with our own mind. We need to be willing to face up to what's going on in our mind before we can do anything about it. So if we are dealing with that deeper, wordless anxiety and that feeling of seemingly baseless, persistent dread, well, the first thing is feeling it. Allowing yourself to face it, to acknowledge what's happening. And this does not mean feeding it, does not mean fueling it. So this is where things get tricky, is because many of us have basically two modes towards any given emotion. We have the mode of ignoring it, and we have the mode of participating in it. So either we pretend there's nothing there, I'm not angry, nope. Or we're just going full on rage mode. I hate you all. So that's not what we're doing in Buddhist practice. So in Buddhist practice, we're not ignoring what's coming and going in the mind. But also, if something is unwholesome, then we choose not to participate in it. We choose not to strengthen it or indulge in it because we know that that's harmful. We know that that's only going to cause damage. So we want to cultivate a clear awareness of exactly what we're feeling in the mind, but without fueling or strengthening anything that's unwholesome, which includes that pervasive feeling of worry or anxiety or fear or dread. We don't want to strengthen it or fuel it in any way. But we do want to be aware of it and to watch it very closely. And as we watch it very closely, there's a few things that start to become apparent. First off, it's not stable. It's not steady. It's impermanent. It's constantly changing. Sometimes it's there. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's weak. Sometimes it's strong. It's constantly changing. Even the feeling of it is constantly changing moment by moment. It's not exactly the same all the time. It's the first thing that we notice. The second thing that we might start to recognize is that we are engaging with it to some degree. There's a certain amount of activity that we're doing, which is keeping it going in the mind. There's something we're doing that keeps it rolling around in the mind. And as we look closely at it, we can start to see that volitional component. And as we see the volitional component, it gets easier to disengage, to pull back. A third thing that we'll start to notice is that it's not who we are. It's just something that's present in the mind. And this is a very important recognition because this is what makes it possible to let go of it. One of the major problems with emotions is that we tend to think they're who we are. We think, I am anxious. I am an anxious person. I am angry. I am an angry person. I am greedy. I am a greedy person. We tend to think that way, whether we put it in those words or not. We tend to think that way. We tend to identify as our emotions. We tend to identify as the patterns of mind. But when we look at them closely, then we start to recognize that it's not who we are. It's just things coming and going in the mind. Just as I'm not the sound of the fan is just something coming and going in the mind. I'm not Azafu. Azafu is just something that's coming and going in the mind. The same way I am not anxiety. It's just something that's coming and going in the mind. So that alone gives us a tremendous buffer, tremendous cushion, which allows us to experience the emotion but without being disturbed by it, without getting wrapped up in it. Because we're switching from the first person perspective of involvement to the third person perspective of observation. And that alone, again, is enough to disconnect from it. It's like the difference between watching a movie about somebody getting mugged and actually getting mugged yourself. Like, when you're getting mugged, it's like, wow, this is really unpleasant, I wish this wasn't happening. When you're just watching a movie, then you always, some part of you knows that it's not you. So it doesn't disturb you. It might still disturb you a little bit, but that's because there's a tendency to get wrapped up in movies and watching movies, which is another reason why I don't watch movies. So it's the same. When we start to look at our emotions from a third-person perspective, then we stop getting wrapped up in them. There starts to be a certain quality of non-reality or unreality to them, right? In that it's not something that we need to take personally. It's not something that we need to get absorbed into, which means that it's not something that we need to be disturbed by. And we can start to disengage, we can start to pull back. So just that shift in perspective already greatly diminishes the power it has over the mind. And also it tends to lead towards that pattern of anxious thinking, that feeling of anxiety to start to melt away, to start to dissolve. So we're getting towards the end of our time, so I think I'd like to leave some time for questions. So I'll go ahead and stop there. Are there any questions or comments at this time? Yeah.
So you talked about how at some point in our life, we have had every pleasant experience, we have had every unpleasant experience. And we think getting something or getting a job, getting someone, whoever, will make us happy. But what if that did happen in our past and it did make us happy and we didn't voluntarily walk away from it or lose it, but we lost it or it walked away because of factors outside our control. So we know it made us happy in the past and we think it will still make us happy if we get it again. But I understand the Buddhist teaching about detachment and we shouldn't get attached to a job or a person or whatnot, but how do you break that cycle where, you know, something made you happy, you lost it, not for something outside your control, and how do you stop yourself from thinking it'll make you happy again? Does that make sense?
Yeah. Because you've already seen the answer to that question. Because you already saw that it was an unreliable source of happiness. You got it, but you couldn't keep it. So what makes you think you'll keep it this time?
Even though
you'll just get another temporary burst of pleasure and then you'll lose it.
Temporary
might be 10 seconds or 10 years, but either way it's temporary.
Even though you lost it, not for fault of your own.
Well, it doesn't matter why. The point is that it's not something that is sustainable. It's temporary. So that's why it's not a reliable source of happiness.
I have a second question. It's really stupid.
That's
but you mentioned you don't watch movies. Are Buddhist monks allowed to watch movies?
Usually not. At some monasteries, there's a movie night once or twice a year.
What kind of movies do you guys watch usually?
Buddhist movies. So actually, the last movie I watched was a documentary about hermit monks in the mountains of China. What's that?
I love that documentary.
Oh yeah, it's great. Yeah. Yep. Anything else?
I have a question. I think for me, one of my main anxieties a lot is, like, how do I act in the most harmless way towards other people when I'm moving about in the world? I think that causes me a lot of anxiety. I'm always like, oh no, what should I do in this situation? What is the nicest way to go about it? What's, like, the least harmful way to, like, you know, deal with this work or this person or whatever? And I find that that causes me anxiety.
Well, so that's a pretty wholesome form of anxiety, so bonus points. So it's acknowledging that there is a wholesome element there and that you want to be harmless. But it's important also to recognize that that motive to be harmless, coupled with mindfulness, means that whatever situation you face, you'll naturally do what seems like the most harmless thing. So that's good enough. So there's no need to be anxious because you already have all the prerequisites for doing the best in every situation. And also acknowledging that you will sometimes encounter situations where you make bad choices for whatever reason, either because you don't have enough information or because you don't understand clearly or maybe because of some lingering defilement or delusion in your mind, or whatever it is. And that's okay. That's okay. That's to be expected. So we make mistakes, and we learn from them, and we move on. So also cultivating confidence. Have you learned from past mistakes? Have you made mistakes before? Did you learn anything from them?
Yeah.
So then you know that you can learn from mistakes. You don't need to be afraid of them. I've made so many mistakes in my life, it's ridiculous. But if I kept making the same mistakes over and over again, that would be a problem. But if I learn from my mistakes and I commit to doing better, then the mistakes are actually useful because they're part of the training mechanism by which we move closer to Buddhahood. So you don't need to be afraid of making mistakes. Before the Buddha became the Buddha, he made countless mistakes. That was how he became the Buddha, was by making mistakes and learning from them. That's how everyone becomes a Buddha, is by making mistakes and learning from them. So you don't need to be afraid of making mistakes. You just need to commit yourself to learning from the mistakes that you make. Does that help?
Very much so.
Great. Yeah.
Question. Now, piggybacking on that, but when you, like, see the good in other people, and of the soul, and you know, everybody has a good in them, it's just a matter of choice. If they keep disappointing you, or like people keep disappointing you, like, where do you draw the line? Like, what do you learn from it? Because, you know, end of the day, they're a human being and they have good in them, but then what is the lesson that you learn from you? Because you, like, this is what I, my experience has been sometimes, that you give and give and give, and then, you know, I don't know how to say it. It's just like what do you get out of it? From your experience, good and bad, both of it combined, and eventually it fades. So what is the lesson that you do learn that is, doesn't matter? Like, what is the lesson?
So coming back to something you said earlier, if someone disappoints you, it's because you expected something from them. So the problem wasn't them, it was you. It was that you had an expectation. Expectations are predetermined dukkha.
Even if the expectation is for them to be better, or for them to achieve more.
Yep, still dukkha. Yep. You're setting yourself up to suffer. Other people are not in your control. They will do whatever they do. So if you have any expectations at all, you will suffer.
Not have any expectations. Like, you know, you think you don't have expectations, but you do.
Yeah. Buddhism is hard. It's really hard. I wish it was easy. It's not. It's really hard. I'm sorry. But what else are you going to do?
Like, you know, because intrinsically, I mean, that's who you are. So you can't stop being you, but then you have to take the expectation away. I don't know how to do it.
Well, the first thing is seeing it. The second thing is recognizing that it's a choice you're making, and recognizing that it's foolish and self-destructive. And then you'll start to let go. Yeah, and as you cultivate samadhi, it gets easier. As you cultivate this mental stability, this unification of mind, this steady, strong, stable mind, it gets easier and easier to break your cycles. Well, you need to be considerate of the people around you. So in the case of if you're sad and your body starts producing tears, well, there's actually not a huge amount you can do about that. So I'm not the best person to talk to about crying because I don't, as a general rule, very rarely. There's another monastic who would be much better to ask about that, but she's not here today. But as far as anger, yeah, you really don't want to express it. You don't. The closest you can do is you can say something like, I'm feeling a lot of anger coming up and I don't want to express it. So talking about it, but expressing it is not a good idea. So like speaking loudly and harshly, not a good idea. So you don't want to manifest anger. It's very destructive, both to yourself and to others. So in those situations, it's good to do whatever you can to not manifest it. And sometimes that means removing yourself from the situation. If you really feel like you're not going to be able to hold it in, then remove yourself from the situation as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
You have a question?
Yeah. So you said something earlier, and everyone started laughing, and I wasn't sure if you were like half joking, but you said nothing is actually okay.
Oh, yeah, I did say that. Yeah.
Yeah. And so I'm trying to embrace that. Radical acceptance lately as an approach, and I within that, my understanding is to approach things with like whatever I'm feeling is okay, or whatever's happening here that is causing physical fluctuations within myself, that's okay too. So is it like a paradox, or is it something that can both can be reconciled, or can you just clarify?
Well, it's different ways of approaching practice. So the attitude of everything is okay, that's a way of dealing with our tendency towards shutting out parts of our experience. So that's particularly useful if we are prone towards negligence or willful ignorance or like not, or repressing or not seeing parts of our experience. Or if we're prone towards unnecessary judgmentalism, then you can take on that practice for a period of time. But it's actually not quite useful past a certain point, because we do need to have the judgment of wholesome and unwholesome. So if we just say everything is okay, well then child abuse is okay. Is it? I don't think so. It's part of samsara. It's actually an inseparable part of samsara. It doesn't go away. But that doesn't mean it's okay. It's definitely not okay. So we accept it as being part of reality, but we also acknowledge that it's unwholesome, not to be done, not to be supported, not to be approved of. So everything is okay, that attitude is useful to a point, but we need to be careful not to allow it to go to the point where it overwrites conscience. Because actually then you can just get right into overriding the path to enlightenment. Everything is okay, so I'm not going to meditate today or at all this month. Everything is okay, so I don't need to follow the precepts. Everything is okay, so I'm going to go rob a bank. I mean, it goes downhill really quickly. So just recognizing that that statement has provisional, limited application. But if we take it too far, it destroys the entire spiritual path. So the statement, nothing is okay, actually qualified that a moment later by saying that the reason why nothing is okay is because we're not enlightened, which means that we're continually creating dukkha for ourselves. No matter what situation we're in, we find some way to make that situation unpleasant. That's why nothing is okay. It's not that things are inherently either okay or not okay. Things just are what they are. But because we are unenlightened, we have the habit of making ourselves unhappy. No matter what situation we're in, we find some way to make it dukkha, some way to make it unpleasant. That's why I said nothing is okay. Because actually for an enlightened being, everything really is okay. But for them, that's coming from a place of wisdom, a place of knowing the nature of reality at such a bedrock level that they see how absolutely everything fits together. So that they see the inseparability of all things. But an enlightened being also has a naturally pure mind, which means that they're actually incapable of doing anything immoral. An enlightened being could never intentionally harm someone. It's just not possible. But at the same time, they recognize that harming is an inseparable part of reality. So that's where this, everything is okay. That perspective is useful at the very beginning of the path when we're dealing with willful ignorance. And it's useful at the very end of the path, very end of the path. So when you attain awakening, then it becomes relevant. But all the time in between, no, that's not the most useful approach to take. So recognizing that it has a place, but don't take it outside of its place, because it causes problems. Okay. I think a lady in the back had a question. Yeah. So from a Buddhist perspective, enlightenment is irreversible. So the Buddha, Shakyamuni Buddha 2500 years ago attained enlightenment, and he taught for 45 years, and then he passed away. So for that entire time he was enlightened. He never reverted. And then since then, both during the time he was alive, many of his disciples attained awakening. And also throughout the centuries since, many people have followed his instructions and attained awakening. So the teachings of the Buddha are quite clear on this point. Enlightenment is irreversible. Once you attain it, there's no going back. Which is not a problem, by the way, because it's infinitely better than what we're experiencing. But after attaining enlightenment, you still have a human body. And you can still interact with the human world. And in fact, enlightened beings tend to be, since their minds are completely pure, they have no unwholesome tendencies, they tend to naturally be very kind, compassionate beings. They have perfect wisdom. So compassion and wisdom means that there are very potent forces for good in the world. They tend to do what they can to help others develop that same liberating wisdom that they've developed. So we're out of time, so we really should stop now. Thank you all for coming.